Hey everybody, thanks for watching. And a lot of people praise Jesus every day. Now what I want to show in this video that Jesus is not the Son of God. Nobody know who God is, but I want to show that Jesus is the Son, S-U-N, not the Son, S-O-N. Now what you got to think about is this. Way back during ancient times, the most scariest thing to people was the night. Because at night, it got dark, it was pitch black outside, and you couldn't see all the predator animals coming out to eat people and to, you know, cause mischief. So the sun basically helped keep the people warm. It grew the crops, it made rain so the crops can grow. You know, the sun was their savior. It was their risen savior from the darkness. Now, most ancient races worship the sun. The Egyptians worshiped Ra, they worshiped Amon, and they worshiped Horus. These were sun deities. Now, basically, you had Ra, which was a representation of the sun. He was a sun god. That's where you basically get Jesus. Jesus is basically a representation of the sun. Now, they show you this in many ways. They show it to you in the Bible, and they show it to you all over the world. People just can't put it together because they don't know what to look for. Now, let me show you how they throw this stuff in your face in ways that's harder to see than others. Now, this is the cross of the zodiac. Now, if you ever look at the cross of the zodiac, you always see that there's a sun in the middle. Now, this sun represents Jesus, or represents God. Now, basically, what you have is on December 21st begins the winter solstice. Now, from December 22nd to December 25th, the sun is dead. It basically does not move. And that's how the ancients saw it. They saw it as the sun dying on December 22nd because it didn't move for 3 whole days. On December 25th, the sun moves 1 degree north. So it is said in the Bible, Jesus rose on the third day. And he died on the cross. It's not so much a cross, it's the cross of the zodiac, not a physical cross. And he rose on the third day. He was born again. So it says Jesus' birthday is on December 25th, Christmas. It means he was born again on December 25th. The reason why they make his risen day Easter, which is in the springtime, is because Easter, or the spring, it begins when the sun is on the equator. It's at the midpoint of the earth, and it starts its way back. It marches, then springs towards summer. So the sun is at the equator around springtime. And that's why I said Jesus rose again, because you start seeing the miracles of the sun during the spring. So what happens? The lakes melt, and you start to see the sun walking on water. What else happened? Plants grow. You know, it bring the dead alive. The dead plants come back to life. What else happened? You have grapes. Now, you have the sun creates rain. So it rains on these grapevines and they grow grapes. So basically you have the sun changing water into wine. So the vineyard started to grow grapes. And it is divine, or the vine on the grapevine. So it's not a play on words. This is all where they get this stuff from. And because you think it's play on words, because your mind is not putting this stuff together, you don't see how easy it is to figure out where they got these stories from. Now, Jesus had 5 wounds. He had one in each hand, he had one in each foot, and he had the one in the rib, the one that it said that basically killed him. Those 5 wounds represent the 5 winter months, or the 5 months that the sun is at its lowest point. So you have October, November, December, January, February, the 5 months. That's what they represent. Now, if you look at the zodiac, you can see where those months would fit. Then you get to March, and then the sun marches up, springs back into action, and heads to its highest point. Which is the summertime, when it's really warm, when everything starts to happen. Okay, so just look at the cross of the zodiac. If you ever look at the cross of the zodiac, you'll always see in the middle that circle, or the sun is there. So if you take just that cross out, you'll have what you see at the top of churches. Most churches have that cross, and it's always that circle there. That circle represents the sun, because it's the sun on the cross of the zodiac. That sun is Jesus. which is why when you see pictures of Jesus, you see the sun behind his head, or the halo. The halo, the crown of thorns that they put on his head, represents the sun rays of the sun. This is where it all comes from. It is not a play on words. This is where they got the story from. If you do your research, if you just read the Bible, you'll see exactly what they have done. Okay, so let's look at the Bible. The Bible hints a lot about this. They give you little hints, a little clues, trying to tell you that Jesus, God, is the Son. Now, if you look at Job 36, starting at verse 24, it tells you this. It says, remember that thou magnify his works. Now, ask yourself, what is it talking about? Is it talking about God or the Son, which men behold? Every man may see it. Man may behold it afar off. You behold the Son afar off. Behold, God is great. He just called God the Son, and we know him not. Neither can the number of his years be searched out, for he maketh the drops of water, they pour down rain according to the vapor thereof. The sun makes water vapor to create rain, which the clouds do drop and distill upon man abundantly. The sun does this. Also, can any understand the spreading of the clouds? What spreads the clouds? The sun, and the noise of his tabernacle, thunder. Behold, he spreadeth his light upon it. Who? Is it the sun or God? He's talking about the sun. And covereth the bottom of the sea. What covereth? I mean, you can see the sun on the water. It's clearly talking about the sun. But I'm going to give you another one. Let's look at Joshua chapter 10, starting at verse 12. Let's go to 14. But let's start at 12. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the midst of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is this not written in the book of Jezer? Jezer is another book they left out of the Bible. So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hastened not to go down about a whole day. Now, this is the part you got to really read. And there was no day like that before it or after it that the Lord, notice he just called the sun the Lord, he just called the sun God, hearken unto the voice of a man for the Lord fought for Israel. Pay attention to what you're reading. This is how they trick you. If you just read again from 12 to 14, it's talking about the sun. Then it automatically just switches off and calls the sun the Lord, God. Now, why would it say the Lord hearken unto the voice of a man for the first time in this verse, when we know that the Lord hearkened to many men in the Bible? It said no day like this before or after it that the Lord hearkened unto a man. We know that's bullshit. What about Moses? What about Noah? What about Job? What about Daniel? What about all the people in the Bible that the Lord hearkened to? This is another thing that people don't realize when they read the Bible, because they lose all common sense. It just called God the Son. Now, if you think this is all some kind of coincidence, then you are more brainwashed than you realize. You have to understand that if you're going to create something like the Bible and use it to control people, you're going to have fail-safes. And if they're fail-safe, their excuse for every problem with the Bible is Satan or the devil did it. And that's what they use. They play off of your fear. They play off of your emotions. They play off of your hope. Because rich people don't need hope. They can buy just about everything they need. Poor people need hope. People who need some kind of help need hope. And the problem is, the reason why people don't want to let this Bible go is because their life is not right. And it's hard for them to get their life where they want to be. They have hopes and dreams. And because they can't get it on their own, or because no person physically will help them out, they seek some kind of divine help, some kind of help from a presence that's beyond this world or beyond this whole physical material world that we live in. And what they've done is they're preying on that. They're preying on your hope. They're preying on your desperation and your want for a better life. See, but the problem is this. Don't nobody do any research, and don't nobody ask any questions. They just accept this book as is. I mean, there's some major things in this book that I don't understand how people could just sit back and accept it as a fact just because they want some money or because they want a material thing. People are not religious for spiritual gain. They become religious because they hate their life and they want a better life for themselves, and they know this. Now, if you go back in history and research what was going on with the Bible, you see that other leaders seen that the Catholic Church was doing really good at controlling areas with this religion. So they copied and came up with their own religions. That's what the Crusades was all about. It was about them going out and wiping out all these other copiers, all these other religions. It's like if you're the mob and you running something, and then this other group comes along and try to set up shop on your turf, it's going to be a street battle. It's going to be a battle. It's going to be a war. That's what the Crusades was about. They were saying, hey, we came up with this religion thing first. We're going to come and knock y'all off and make y'all people worship our God. And that's what they did. And over time, it stuck. The Bible is a weapon. If you ever seen the movie, The Book of Eli, they kind of hint to it. Listen to this clip.
For a fucking book.
It's not a fucking book. It's a weapon. A weapon aimed right at the hearts and minds of the weak and the desperate. It will give us control of it. If we want to rule more than one small fucking town, we have to have it. People will come from all over. They do exactly what I tell them if the words are from the book.
It's happened before. And it'll happen again. All we need is that book.
The Bible is still being used today as a weapon to control people. And until you have faith in yourself and realize you can get what you want on your own, you will always be a slave. Thanks for watching this video. Please comment and share it because Facebook limits my posts. Thanks for watching.